Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our fourth meeting of 2023. And although our first meeting is under a new name and slightly adjusted remit, we're now called the Rural Affairs and Islands Committee. Before we begin, can I ask all those members using electronic devices to please turn them to silent? Our first item of business this morning is consideration of petition PE1951 on behalf of the Scottish Creel Fishermen's Federation, calling on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to reinstate inshore coastal limit on the use of dredge and trawl fishing gear. And I welcome to the meeting the petitioner, Alistair Bally-Philp, and invite him to make some opening remarks.
Hi, thank you. Good morning, everyone. The petition is submitted on the basis that we believe, it's quite succinct really, that we believe that the existing plans and policies of the Scottish Government aren't capable of achieving our national and international commitments. Those are to achieve good environmental status and other commitments under the Sustainable Development Goals and the UK 2020 Fisheries Act. For example, good environmental status requires us to have only 15% of our seabed highly disturbed, and the most recent assessment of the Scottish Government was that 58% of our seabed was highly disturbed. So if we look at the Government's proposals to mitigate these issues, we can see that we're looking at introducing 10% highly protected marine areas and a priority marine features review, as well as a cap on fishing effort within the inshore. I think it's quite easy to see that cumulatively, these are not capable of achieving an area of the seabed of only 15% being highly disturbed. Accordingly, we need to introduce comprehensive and very extensive spatial management to our inshore to meet those international objectives. And I believe that introducing something akin to the former three-mile limit, and I'd like to just clarify, we're not asking for the old three-mile limit. We think something like a variation on that original limit. And what I mean by that is spatial management on an equivalent scale. So seascape spatial management is the only thing that's going to be capable of allowing us to meet our commitments to achieve good environmental status.
Thank you very much. I think that's given us a good overview of the petition. Jenny Minto.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Bally, for coming along. Can you just, for the record, say why do you think a modern inshore coastal limit is needed?
I think unless we introduce spatial management on a scale, then we are not going to be able to achieve good environmental status. But one of the things about a modern inshore limit is that it could also facilitate and incentivise a transition towards more low-impact fisheries, which is another obligation that we have under the Fisheries Act. And so what I mean by that is if you create an area that you can exclusively use for creel fishing, line fishing and net fishing, then people will adopt those techniques. Whereas if you allow those people using those low-impact gears and you ask them to compete directly with the more industrialised fisheries, the odds are these bigger boats and the more industrialised fisheries will monopolise the resource base. So unless you introduce a limit and spatial management that's at least on the scale of the former three-mile limit, then I don't think we can do the things that we're committed to do, like incentivising lower impact fisheries or achieving good environmental status.
Okay, thank you.
Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Convener. I suppose you've just indicated why it is you feel that measures are needed. Can I ask you why or whether you think that there would be, in the longer term, some benefit to the creeling industry if the measures you're proposing were taken?
Oh, for sure. I think there's some assessments that have been done, some by the Scottish Government themselves, a document called Assessing the Options for Change, which was a review of the potential for what would happen if we introduced a three-mile limit, and some work by the New Economics Foundation, as well as Professor Alan Radford, have all indicated that if we transition to fishing grounds in the inshore to creeling, we could actually employ more fishermen, and we can do this without actually catching any more fish, or in this case would be shellfish. And the reason for that is that creel-caught shellfish attracts a premium. And so the same, say, nephrops or langoustine that was caught by a trawler, if it was caught by a creel boat, would fetch four times as much. That means without catching a single extra nephrop, you could employ four times as many fishermen. So, yes, it would benefit the creel sector. I think it would also benefit the environment and benefit our coastal communities as well.
Thank you.
Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. I'd appreciate it if you could, so you talked a bit about the Fisheries Act and you've also mentioned good environmental status. I'd appreciate it if you could explain what is meant by ecosystems, an ecosystems approach as set out in the Fisheries Act 2020, and how does good environmental status relate to that? And also, could you touch on, and you've kind of already begun to, but a bit more, on whether or not, in your view, Scotland's fisheries management is compliant with an ecosystems approach?
Yes, okay. So an ecosystems approach, as it's described in the Fisheries Act, is that the collective pressures are kept with levels that are compatible with achieving good environmental status. That's the legal definition. It's a little bit clunky. So maybe in simpler terms, what we're talking about is instead of managing individual species, which is currently the way that we manage most fisheries, we manage the actual environment where these species live. So, for example, at the moment, we're managing nephrops under a system called maximum sustainable yield. It's a single species management for nephrops to keep our catching limits under that which the nephrops can sustainably cope with. But that doesn't look at the environment. It doesn't look at the social or economic consequences. So again, if you swap prawn creeling or nephrops creeling for nephrops trawling, the environment would benefit considerably and we would generate more revenue. But under single species management plans, that isn't taken into account. So an ecosystems-based approach would look at the whole ecosystem and the impacts social, economically and environmentally of any particular fishing method in any particular area.
I've got a follow-up. So in its response to the petition, the Scottish Government states that it has a tailored approach on inshore management. Can I ask for your thoughts on what that means? For example, is it tailored to achieving ecosystems management and good environmental status for the foreseeable future?
I mean, I don't think so. I think it's really up to the Scottish Government to explain what they mean by a tailored approach and how that would achieve good environmental status. But all the indicators that I can see are that there's no plans or proposals currently on the table from the Scottish Government that are capable of achieving good environmental status. And I reiterate that good environmental status has several indicators, one of which is the seabed, benthic habitat indicator, which states that only 15% of the seabed can be highly disturbed. There's nothing currently on the table which is capable of getting us anywhere close to that.
Thanks, Convener.
Thank you. Karen Adam.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Alistair. Nice to see you. You spoke about there's been a variation on the previous 3-mile limit, and I'm just wondering, can you explain what your understanding is of the implementation of the previous 3-mile limit?
Okay, so the original 3-mile limit was actually more than a 3-mile limit. So there was a basic strip right around the coastline of Scotland that was the 3-mile limit, that was generically known as the 3-mile limit, but we also closed most of the Firths and the Forths. So the Firth of Forth, the Firth of Clyde, Sound of Jura, Moray Firth, and so on were also closed. So we closed these big wedges of inland seas that we have, and we allocated them the same legal criteria that we did for the 3-mile limit. Now, the 3-mile limit explicitly prohibited demersal towed gear and beam trawling. Now, it's interesting that in the interim, scallop dredging developed, and scallop dredging is actually a type of beam trawling. So a lot of people argue that scallop dredging was never prohibited by the original 3-mile limit, but I would argue that it should have been, because scallop dredging is towing a beam and beam trawling was prohibited. And it's worth saying at this point too that there were a lot of exceptions. There were exceptions for small boats under a certain tonnage, and there were exemptions for towing certain types of gear in certain areas that had sort of historical entitlement. And then over time, more and more bylaws were passed that allowed more and more mobile gear in the inshore. So it was a very complicated and convoluted system. And in the end, that was one of the arguments for getting rid of the 3-mile limit, was that it was too complex and there were too many exceptions and exemptions to the rule. But for the basic premise of the 3-mile limit was that you shouldn't tow mobile demersal fishing gear across the seabed within 3 miles of land or within the inshore waters.
Thank you.
Thank you. You said that the limit was removed because it was too complicated, but the Cameron report suggested it was removed because it could not be justified in grounds of conservation and recommended the removal of the restrictions for the benefit of the fishing community.
The Cameron report cited quite a lot of reasons for removing the 3-mile limit. One was that it just wasn't being complied with. And one of the arguments was that it wouldn't make any difference if you remove it or not. Also that it was almost impossible to enforce. And you've got to remember at the time we had a coal-powered fisheries enforcement vessel, no GPS, no vessel tracking, and no even VHF radios. So there were a lot of grounds for removing the 3-mile limit cited in the Cameron report. And to be honest with you, the one that I would dispute the most is that there was no conservation benefit. And I think in this day and age, as we are in the middle of a biodiversity and a climate crisis, we're starting to understand more and more the implications of and the consequences of trawling and dredging inshore. And I would like, just like to add to that, that the Scottish Government explicitly acknowledges the single biggest impact on our marine environment is trawling and dredging. So I think that all the facts now would refute what the Cameron Report conclusion in the 1970s.
You talk about facts. What research actually backs up your justification to say that the Cameron Report was wrong on the grounds of conservation, removing it did benefit fishing communities? What research has been done since then?
So there's several pieces of research. One that's probably worth bringing in is the Clyde Ecosystems Review, which shows that the inshore sea of the Clyde, which was previously, it was closed until the 1960s. That was one of the wider firths or fourths. And then the 3 mile limit was removed in the mid 1980s. And since that time, we've seen catastrophic declines in almost all demersal finfish inshore landings. At one point in our past, we were employing many tens of thousands of fishermen catching demersal finfish. I believe now there is not a single fisherman left in Scotland who makes his living exclusively catching demersal finfish inshore. So inshore fish populations have catastrophically collapsed since the removal of the 3 mile limit. I think that's clear enough evidence.
Rachel Hamilton.
Yeah, it was just on the 3 mile limit, actually, in terms of where the restrictions exist on fishing similar to those proposed in your petition, where topography makes it harder for smaller fishing boats to adapt to being displaced further afield. I mean, do you have examples of that, and can you give us what you believe might be the impact?
Okay, so, yeah, I mean, I think this is a two-way street. We've got to remember that the boats that suffer displacement worst are the smallest static gear boats, that would be the creel boats. The vast majority of Scotland's inshore fishing fleet are under 10-metre creel boats. And so by making them compete directly with trawlers, there is already very, very extensive displacement, and displacement which is giving us poor social, economic and environmental outcomes versus not having that displacement. And it works the other way. If we were to introduce a 3 mile limit, the smallest trawlers would in turn be displaced. It's arguable that for each trawler that you displace, you could have, or each two-man trawler, so an equivalent creel boat, you could have four equivalent creel boats for every two-man trawler that you would displace. So yes, there would be displacement. We would need to implement some kind of a just transition. There's no doubt about that. But I think we have to do that regardless of whether or not we introduce a three-mile limit. The Scottish Government has an obligation to meet good environmental status. That can't be achieved without comprehensive and extensive spatial management. So whether we call it a three-mile limit or not, somebody somewhere is going to have to be displaced. The fishing industry is over capacity to achieve good environmental status. That's just a simple fact.
And just on my point about where you could possibly demonstrate that there's a similar example somewhere else in Scotland, for example, the Moray Firth. I mean, has that, what impact has that had in terms of the different topography?
I think the thing about the different topography is that there are different seabed types support different kinds of fishing industry. At the moment, we do have relatively extensive closures, but I believe the figure is only a few percent, like 3% of ground that is capable of being trawled on is actually closed to trawling. Most of the fisheries closures we have is on ground that trawlers weren't using. That's why it was amenable to the fishing industry to allow those closures to go ahead. There are other examples of places where closures have been put in place. Lyme Bay in England is a very good example. I believe in Wales there's a 1 mile limit on towed gear and a 3 mile limit on any vessel over 10 metres. I believe in Norway, and we are looking at a 12-mile limit for almost all towed demersal gears. Lyme Bay in England's got a fantastic project that's been running for over 10 years, where they excluded scallop dredging and trawling, and that's allowed the development of a very, very buoyant and robust small-scale fishing industry. And there was a recent study there done that said that the fishing in Lyme Bay Reserve is not only sustainable, but that it creates the highest level of happiness within fishermen that's been measured around the country. And I think, considering that the fishing industry is under pressure everywhere, that's the kind of thing we should be looking for, both to incentivise new entrants into fishing and to facilitate sustainable fishing.
We do need to take displacement very seriously. And, I mean, off the Wash, the topography has demonstrated that it has displaced smaller fishermen and they have had to go further out to protect their livelihoods. So I think there could be arguments for based on both sides, but your argument is that we should make have a transition, which we'll discuss later within the questioning, but that we have to make a sacrifice almost. Is that what you're saying? But then that argument doesn't stand up, does it? Where, with the example in Norway, the Norwegian fleets, where they're not placing restrictions for conservation efforts, they're replacing it to ensure that they restrict gear conflicts.
I think gear conflict is part of what's going on in Norway, but there is huge social and economic and environmental benefits when you remove mobile demersal gear and manage static gear well in the zone. And it's probably worth emphasising that at this stage, that if you're going to displace mobile gear, then you need to manage the static gear better. So nobody is proposing, like we introduced a three-mile limit in absence of improving the management of the static gear. But I think the question comes down to, do we have to displace any fishing industry at all? And if we do, which fishing industry should be displaced? There will be huge benefits from displacing trawl, and there would be far fewer benefits from displacing creel. So arguably, if we have to displace anybody, it should be those activities that give us the poorest social, economic and environmental outcomes. Unfortunately, it's not the same people that benefit from the displacement that pay the price for the displacement. Accordingly, we need some kind of a just transition to facilitate this.
OK. I've got one more small question on this, because I'm not sure if other members were going to mention this at all, but obviously we have spatial squeeze right now, and the renewable energy, offshore energy sector is also making it challenging to understand how we see the future of fishing. Do you have concerns around the spatial squeeze as well, on top of the way that you're wanting to bring in restrictions through your petition?
Yes, so I think one of the reasons we're proposing this is because of spatial squeeze, and I appreciate that on the face of it might appear like this would compound spatial squeeze, and it would for certain sectors of the fishing industry. There's no doubt about that. The problem with spatial squeeze is that we're potentially going to lose a significant proportion of our fishing grounds over the next 30 years, and that's going to cause displacement of fishing activity. When it comes to just flat competition, survival of the fittest between the various fishing sectors, the biggest boats normally win and the mobile boats normally win. Now, that's the opposite outcome that the Scottish Government has committed itself to. We're obliged to incentivise wherever possible low-impact fishing and fishing methods which have a reduced impact on the environment. And if we allow spatial squeeze to take place in the absence of introducing management or mitigations, then we're going to get the opposite from what we've committed to. The introducing a spatial closure to mobile gear and the inshore will actually help mitigate spatial squeeze, and it will actually allow us to employ more fishermen. And this is the interesting thing, not fishermen with the same gear, so it's not the same fishermen, not unless we facilitate a just transition. But creating a three-mile limit should allow us to employ at least the same amount of fishermen, if not more fishermen. So it's a mitigation for spatial squeeze.
Mercedes Villalba, followed by Alistair Allen.
Thank you. Good morning. Just going back to the discussion around the original three-mile limit and with reference to the Cameron report, is it fair to say that that report's conclusions that the original limit could not be justified on conservation grounds weren't based on an ecosystems approach? They didn't factor in the impact on the seabed and related species, and that research and evidence in this area has moved on, and we now have a greater understanding of the importance of ecosystems management.
Good morning. And I think, that's a perfect assessment of the situation. Initially, when the Cameron report came out, we didn't really understand the ecosystems approach, and we certainly didn't try and implement it. But at the moment, the Scottish Government has legal obligation to implement the ecosystems-based approach. And I think if we were to do that now, we would come to very different conclusions than the Cameron report came to in the 70s.
Thank you, Convener. Looking at the argument that's been made here by, obviously, some of this is about introducing a variation on what was the historic limit, which, as you know better than I do, was brought in historically to keep out steam-powered vessels from coastal areas. And from what you're saying today, the variation seems to be around trying to find a spatial management that works. And that seems to be a bit of a holy grail. This comes up in this committee very often, spatial management. So can you say how the variation would work from the historic system and what the spatial management solution would look like.
Okay, yeah. So I think we have to be very clear that it's demersal towed bottom contact gear that is causing us to fail our obligations under good, to achieve good environmental status. And so any new variation of a 3-mile limit would have to include dredge gears and any gears which were extensively dragged along the seabed. And so if they were exempt, and I'm not sure they were, but a lot of people argue they were, if they were exempted in the original 3-mile limit, they would have to be included in this one. I think another variation that's probably worth considering is that the 3-mile limit was quite a blanket approach. You know, it was a 3-mile strip right round the whole coastline of Scotland, but really our fishing industry doesn't reflect that kind of blanket approach in this day and age. On the west coast of Scotland, 90% of all creels are still deployed within the former 3-mile limit area, and as such, on the west coast of Scotland, there's a very good case that a 3-mile limit would be appropriate on the west coast of Scotland. When it comes to the east coast of Scotland, much of our creel sector is working as far as 12 miles offshore, some even further. So I think when you look at the 3-mile limit, you would want to do equivalent spatial management, that spatial management on that same scale, but you might want to do it as maybe a series of boxes up the east coast. I'm sure if we took the ecosystems-based approach, we would be looking at the seabed, the habitats, the spawning grounds, and where the existing activity is taking place. And we would be able to draw the boxes based on scientific information. But I think it wouldn't be a 3-mile strip on the east coast of Scotland, and we're certainly not arguing for that.
Thank you.
Ali-Anne Burgess.
Thanks. Bally, I'd like to just get a little bit more detail on stuff you've already started touching on. So you've already kind of said that it doesn't necessarily extend around Scotland in a blanket approach. I heard recently that, for example, it might not be needed in Shetland because the seabed is so already abraded by a dynamic sea. So I'd also be interested to hear, are there other ways that we could set the limit other than distance? Like, I heard something about measuring by depth, and you were talking about that a bit, in a way that creelers go out 12 miles, but only 3 on the west coast.
I think that we would have to choose a set of principles to decide what fishing activity would be most appropriate where. So that would be what would give us the best chance of achieving good environmental status, what would protect our priority marine features the best, and what would give us the best social, economic and environmental returns. I'm sceptical about arguments that say because that seabed can be abraded because it's already stormy or something along that lines. Once the seabed gets below maybe 20 metres, there's very few storms on the planet that are capable of detrimentally impacting the seabed to the same extent that scallop dredging or prawn trawling would do. I don't want to appear like I'm just anti-scallop dredging and prawn trawling. I think when it comes to an inshore limit, we need to look at managing the creel sector as well. And there are certain environments where creel should be restricted. And so I'd like to make that clear that even within a 3-mile limit, we have to look at managing fishing activity based on what is necessary to achieve good environmental status. That is our legal commitment, and that should be our aspiration.
And what I understand is what you're trying to get at here with some form of limitation. I think that's helpful where you talk about that we need a set of principles about what gear could be used where. That what we're trying to do is actually create abundance, bring back an abundance that used to be there in terms of our fin fish, our white fish in the inshore, which could then in the future bring back a sector, a thriving sector. But I'm interested also in around enforcement, because you know that kind of came up with the previous limit, and you actually mentioned yourself that it was difficult to enforce. So I just wonder, given budgetary constraints and the fact that limit was removed historically, do you think we could enforce it? I mean, you mentioned we've got much more technology that could help us with that.
A lot of countries around the world who are already doing very comprehensive, modern, progressive fisheries management, and so we could learn from them. And for example, as I say, in Lyme Bay, they've had a policy of no scallop dredging or trawling for over 10 years, and they don't seem to have any problems policing it. In this day and age, you can track your Amazon package and your Uber and all the rest of it. So I can't understand why it would be particularly difficult technologically to manage the fishing industry with very complex and nuanced fisheries management. I think it sounds like it's quite a bold ambition to introduce comprehensive and extensive spatial management. I think it's really worth emphasising that we committed to doing this in 2010 in the Marine Scotland Act. We said we would achieve good environmental status by 2020, and we're nowhere near it. Almost 50% of our fish are fished above maximum sustainable yield out with the scientific advice. That's a breach of the 2020 UK Fisheries Act, and it's a breach of achieving good environmental status. And most of our, not most, but 58% of our seabed is still highly disturbed. So I think if, yes, policing the fishing industry to nth degree and having extensive spatial management is quite bold, but allowing ourselves to continue on the trajectory we are is I would say, far bolder.
And just to clarify, when you're talking about spatial management, what you're meaning is the management of this one gear is, can work in one place and another gear can work in another? Is that part of it?
Yes. So, I mean, spatial management basically says that you have a space and you say that this is suitable for trawling in, this is suitable for dredging in, this is suitable for keeling in, this is suitable for lining in, and then we may look at the social, economic and environmental consequences of that management and say, well, actually, we should allocate more space to lining or more space to netting and so on and so forth. But you're taking an ecosystems-based approach, an area-based approach. And again, I think it's something worth emphasising that we recently introduced the UK Fisheries Act, which committed us to producing a joint fisheries statement, which in turn committed us to producing fisheries management plans. Now, uniquely in Scotland, we have not produced fisheries management plans for any of our shellfish fisheries, which means that the vast majority of fishermen are working in relatively unmanaged fisheries. So Scotland was unique in the UK in not introducing fisheries management plans for shellfish. Now, the vast majority of Scotland's fishermen are employed catching shellfish. So we're very much behind the times on this. And I think spatial management is the only way you can manage shellfish fisheries. The reason the Scottish Government argued that we shouldn't introduce fisheries management plans for shellfish was because we didn't have enough scientific data on how to manage the shellfish stocks. Now, that's fair enough to an extent, but the Fisheries Act also compels us to take the precautionary approach. And it says that in the absence of scientific information, we should act on a precautionary principle. And that would mean that we should introduce area-based fisheries management plans in absence of single species based fisheries management plans. That is spatial management by definition. So it's, we can call them area-based fisheries management plans, we can call it spatial management, we can call it a three-mile limit, but at the end of the day, unless we introduce this kind of you can fish here and you can't fish there, and we do it with a view to achieving good environmental status, we can't meet our international obligations.
Thanks. Thanks, Convener.
Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Convener. Welcome to the committee from Bally. I know very little about fishing. Some total of my fishing knowledge was a day out on a hand dive scallop boat. So I'm going to come to this from a kind of different perspective. It would seem anecdotally that the 3 mile limit works because there was more fish in the past, but in reality, what is the science behind the basis of the 3 mile limit? And if you did set up a 3 mile limit, what is the science to tell us what you're trying to return the fish stocks to?
Okay, these are very good questions and actually quite tricky. So we have some historic baselines for landing. So for a good example is the Clyde. The Clyde is, I'll keep referring to it because we have carried out something called an ecosystem review in the Clyde, and we've looked at the historic fish landings, and we can see from that that the relative abundance in the past was fantastic compared to now. You know, almost 100 to 1. Literally, there's been a 98% decline in demersal fish landings in the Clyde. Now, that doesn't equate to necessarily a 98% decline in fish in the Clyde, but it shows that the fish aren't there to catch anymore. And so we know that once upon a time there were fantastic volumes of fish in the inshore, and we know that when the 3 mile limit was removed, those fish disappeared and we no longer have them. It is just an inference to say that if we removed the pressures which are modifying the habitat and which have the bycatch that's stopping the fish recovering, that the fish would recover. And it's speculative to some degree, but I think it's a reasonable speculation. And evidence-wise, the Scottish Government produced a report, I think it was in 2015, called Assessing the Options for Change, which concluded that the introduction of a 3 mile limit in most areas around Scotland's mainland coast would create more jobs and allow ecosystem recovery. So that's one piece of evidence. We've got the Lamlash Bay around Arran, and the marine protected areas that have restricted trawling so far have all shown significant increases in abundance of most of the species, which are both commercially available and which we also want to protect as priority marine features. And I think the best way to argue this is the inverse, and that is to say that we know for a fact that allowing trawling and dredging inshore is decimating many of our shellfish stocks and our priority marine features. And so I think it's a reasonable inference to say that unless you stop that pressure, and the Scottish Government has recognised trawling and dredging as the single biggest pressure on these environments, then we can't recover those environments.
Okay, thank you.
Some of the language you use is you know, decimating. It's and you say that 58% of our seabed is severely damaged. Where do you get that figure from? And is that 58% of the three within the 3 mile limit or within the 12 mile limit?
So it's within Scottish Sea Area. I believe it's the marine assessment that came up with the figure 58%. It's not highly damaged, highly disturbed. And that means that fragile species that live on the seabed are being decimated. And I think decimated isn't the wrong word to use. I know the Scottish Government took issue with the petition and us using the word decimated. But we've had, in the last 30 years, we've had a 92% decline in cod abundance in the west coast of Scotland. We have a zero tack, which means the ICES, the International Commission for Exploration of the Sea, has said we should not be allowed to catch any cod at all on the west coast of Scotland. I mean, if that's not reflective of a decimated fish population, I don't know what is. And I could give you examples here and use it all your day, but I'll give you a couple more. There has been a 90% decline in serpulid reefs in the Highlands since the last marine assessment, and that's just in one decade. There's been a 99.5% decline in blue mussels in the Moray Firth area. There's been a 52% decline in flame shell beds in the Argyll area. These are all just within a 10-year period. We have no herring quota left on the west coast of Scotland anymore. Herring were once the species, the pivotal keystone species that supplied most of the employment and facilitated much of the ecosystem activity in the west coast of Scotland. We have a zero tack for herring now. So if those things don't reflect a decimated ecosystem, I don't really know what does.
But you're suggesting that's all down. Your petition is all about mobile gear fishing. Surely you're not suggesting that mobile gear fishing is responsible for this. You know, we know that ecosystems are complex. You've said that yourself. And there's lots of different effects and causes for that. We've got global warming. We've got plankton and sand eels, whatever, becoming more abundant further north. We're seeing a reduction in seabirds, whatever. But your petition suggests it's all down to mobile gear within a 3 mile limit. Surely that's not at the moment scientifically based. It's just an assumption you're making that we should have a blanket 3 mile ban. And you've said yourself also there's some places where you maybe wouldn't need a 3 mile ban on the East Coast, whatever. So it's a blanket ban or it's not a blanket ban. Further to what Jim has mentioned, is there any science to back up what you're saying?
Yes, I think there is. First of all, again, back to the Clyde. There was a very good study that looked at the history of fishing in the Clyde and how that related to the declines in the fish stocks. So in the Clyde, I think we can conclude that much of the declines that we have seen are the direct reflection of habitat modification and bycatch associated with trawl and dredge fisheries. An example that Professor Heath gave in a previous Rain Committee hearing was that although trawling only catches 1% of it, Nephrops trawling only catches 1% by weight of cod in the Clyde, that turns out to be two out of three of every single cod in the Clyde get caught each year as a bycatch in Nephrops trawl. And those aren't landed, these are bycaught. Now, the Scottish Government already recognises that the single biggest impact on the marine environment is the impacts of towed demersal gear. And that is the single biggest metric that's stopping us achieving good environmental status. The reason we're trying to achieve good environmental status and the reason one of the metrics says that only 15% should be highly disturbed is because it has already been concluded by society at large that extensively disturbing the seabed is not good for the ecosystem. If you disturb 58% of the seabed like we do, highly disturbed, this isn't like a little brush by with a soft net, this is highly disturbed seabed, 58% of Scotland's seabed is highly disturbed, and a significant proportion of our demersal fin fish are caught as bycatch and dumped overboard, then that has consequences. And the consequences are that we've seen a 98% decline in demersal fish landings at the inshore. And there is some science to back that up. And many countries introducing inshore limits and restrictions on trawling are showing that this is a general consensus that you have to remove those pressures from the environment if you want the environment to recover.
Is there any evidence to suggest that cod move north because of colder waters? And
yes.
Is that not a factor? And again, we're just focusing, it appears that you suggest that disturbance of seabed is wholly responsible for the decline.
Yes, I think there's a general consensus that cod are moving north at something like 2 miles a year. Though that doesn't account for the declines in the cod abundance.
Jim Fairley.
I'd like to, sorry, just to come back on the Cod, so, and okay. again to the Clyde example. In the Clyde, there was a recognised spawning area 20 years ago, and I believe the committee has heard some evidence on this in the past, and that spawning area was recognised that we should protect it in order to protect the Cod. For 20 years, we allowed scallop dredging and trawling on that spawning ground during that spawning season. And in the interim, we're allowing trawlers to catch two-thirds of every cod in the Clyde in each year. I think that there's a reasonable inference that that's why there's no cod in the Clyde.
OK. Jim Fairley.
OK. I get that this is quite a difficult question session for you, Bally. But in terms of the scientific research that has been done, has there been scientific research or is it anecdotal? So is your petition suggesting we close it off for a 10-year period to see what happens? But in that interim 10-year period, you've already talked about what happens to the communities who are reliant on the fish that are happening at the moment. In that 10-year period that you want to close it off for, or whatever length of period of time that it's going to take, you want to see the fish stocks increase. One of the questions I asked you, what are the fish stocks going to be recovered to? Where do you start fishing all over again after that? Because you've already displaced other fishing boats out of the system. And I'm trying to get to this from the point of fairness. How do you actually make what it is that your petition is trying to do fair for everyone who's in the system?
So I think the evidence is clear. The Scottish Government have already committed to achieve good environmental status, and they've already committed to fishing below maximum sustainable yield and in line with the scientific advice, and we're not doing that. So the question is, well, how do we do that? You can't achieve good environmental status without reducing the amount of seabed that's disturbed, which you just cannot do without reducing trawling and dredging. And if you want to fish below maximum sustainable yield, then we have to catch less fish as bycatch. It's simple. I mean, that is the evidence. The evidence has already been conceded by the Scottish Government, and the Scottish Government have already made the commitment to achieve these things. The petition is a mechanism by which we might contribute towards achieving that. Now, in answer to, you, to the second part of your question, which is how do you make it fair, I think we have to recognise that there will be people who will be displaced, and we have to create some kind of a just transition. One of the beauties of something like a three-mile limit is you can employ more people in static gear fisheries than you can in the same equivalent trawl fishery. It's a simple consequence of the premium value that the product attracts. So we can transition much of the existing mobile capacity into the static sector within a three-mile limit. A three-mile limit would be dramatically under capacity. So that, to some degree, would mitigate some of those job losses. And then in future, once we are fishing below maximum sustainable yield, we have to ask ourselves which method gives us the best social, economic and environmental outcomes. And if you have, say, a trawler trying to catch fish versus a handliner trying to catch fish, you will probably find that the handliner offers better social, economic and environmental outcomes. And so we should therefore allocate the fishing opportunity on that basis.
Thank you. Yeah, I think we've covered that quite well. There's just one thing I want to ask you. The 58% that's severely damaged, or you suggested decimated, where do you get that figure from? Can you point the committee where that research is done and where you're getting that figure from?
I believe it comes from the marine assessment, but I will have to commit to coming back to the committee on exactly where that quote comes from. I took it from the briefing note that was supplied to the committee from Open Seas.
OK, thank you. Karen Adam.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you, Alistair, for your answers so far. And, you know, I absolutely don't doubt your sincerity in any of this at all. I've read in the petition, and there's some really bold claims in there. Opportunities to optimise the social, economic and environmental returns, increases in fishing jobs and the revitalisation of coastal communities. Now, as somebody with a coastal community and as my constituency, I know that infrastructure, tourism, support for small businesses, extending ports, helping fishers and farmers to decarbonise, investment in renewable energy and helping discussions between these different industries with the spatial squeeze is a very complex area. So when I see statements like this, I think, okay, so where is the evidence to really support that statement? Because for me, I don't think there is a silver bullet really that can, you know, help all that. And I see this as something that may be throwing something else into the mix. So, you know, where's the evidence to support that statement? And, you know, what will it actually do for coastal communities? How will it help all that complex issues that's going on?
Okay. So, again, I think I would like to just reiterate that the Scottish Government have already recognised that much of this to be true because we've committed to achieving good environmental status and we've committed to fishing below maximum sustainable yield. So in order to achieve that, you have to have extensive spatial management. So the inference that extensive spatial management will lead to improved fish populations and improved environmental health and improved jobs is already implicit in the Scottish Government's commitments and the Sustainable Development Goals and the Marine... So the UK Fisheries Act. It's implicit in all of these things that we have to have extensive spatial management of trawl and dredge gear and more static gears in order to meet our commitments. And those commitments are based on the fact that the government has already recognised these are basic requirements for ecosystem health. And a healthy ecosystem will produce more jobs and more robust coastal communities. But there is actually more direct evidence. So the Scottish Government commissioned a report in 2015 called Assessing the Options for Change, which showed that the introduction of a three-mile limit around Scotland would produce more jobs and supply better ecosystem health and also supply associated jobs such like diving and angling and so on and so forth. There's huge potential jobs that can be created for coastal communities indirectly by introducing good environmental health into our marine ecosystem. Furthermore, the New Economics Foundation in 2016 produced a report on the Scottish nephrops fishery on applying social, economic and environmental criteria. I'll give you a bit of background to that. The Common Fisheries Policy obligated us under Article 17 to use social, economic and environmental criteria as the basis for allocating fishing opportunity. But a lot of people found that quite complicated and they wanted to know how to go about doing that. So the New Economics Foundation wrote a report on how that would be progressed in the Scottish nephrops fishery, and it concluded that swinging the bias towards more creel fishing would employ more fishermen, it would have a reduced impact on the environment, and it would generate more revenues for coastal communities. And I think we can infer from that that there would be more jobs as a consequence. And then lastly, I think the Scottish Creel Fishermen's Federation produced a document called Correcting the Misallocation of Nephrops in the Scottish Inshore Fishing in Inshore Waters, which clearly demonstrated that every time you take an equivalent two-man small-scale trawler out of the system and you could replace it with four two-man creel boats. So without extracting a single extra nephrops, so there would potentially be far more employment, not just directly in the fishing industry, but also indirectly in angling, diving, marine tourism and such like. I think it's a given.
Okay, thank you.
Just some of the things you've covered, we could probably sit here all day at that one question, because it's a great question about how there's the codependency, synergies, trade-offs, whatever. But the Scottish Government have committed to develop a new national marine plan for Scotland by late 2025. Are you hopeful that will cover some of the issues that the question that Karen asked there?
I think the existing marine plan doesn't really deal with fisheries much at all. It deals with other marine spatial planning, excluding fishing. So I think if we're going to have a new marine plan that deals with some of these issues, then it's incumbent upon the Scottish Government to demonstrate how, using that mechanism, they will achieve good environmental status. I mean, this is one of the foundational principles, and both, you know, legally and environmentally, that we have to achieve. We have to achieve good environmental status, and it's a clearly defined thing. So if the marine plan is going to be the solution to this problem, then it's incumbent upon the government to demonstrate how within that context they are going to achieve good environmental status. And personally, I don't think you can get anywhere near good environmental status without introducing very, very comprehensive spatial management, at least on the scale of the three-mile limit.
Thank you. Jenny Minto.
Thank you, Convener. You touched on this earlier in some of your comments, Bally, about the possible risk of the three-mile limit resulting in more creel fishermen. So I'm interested to hear your views on how you can measure that and what measures you can bring in to control that.
Okay, so no, that's a very good question. I think it's one of the best arguments I've heard against the three-mile limit is that in the absence of comprehensive management of the creel sector, you could just be swapping one unsustainable fishing sector for another. And so when we suggest introducing extensive spatial management, it's not in the absence of management of the gear that then, you know, it's incumbent in that space. Now, I think it's really important that we recognise we need fisheries management plans. And the government has committed to this ecosystems-based approach to developing fisheries management plans. We haven't done it. We've just published what we're going to do with fisheries management plans, and they're all single-species fisheries management plans. An ecosystems approach to fisheries management plans would be area-based fisheries management plans. So you would maybe have one for the southwest of Scotland and so on and so forth. And once you had a basic fisheries management plan, you would then have to look at all the individual exceptions, because we have a lot of priority marine features, we have spawning grounds and so on and so forth. So within area-based fisheries management plans, you need local fisheries management plans, right down to the resolution of individual sea locks and individual priority marine features. Now, that can be done, we're just not doing it. We proposed in the Inner Sound of Skye several years ago that we pilot this approach, and that we try developing community-managed fisheries that are based on geographic spaces, which would be the equivalent of an ecosystems-based fisheries management plan. Unfortunately, the Scottish Government pushed very hard against that, and we have no examples of ecosystems-based fisheries management going on in Scotland to date. But it would be a requirement of any specially managed area that we introduce ecosystems-based fisheries management plans, and that would then tell you how much gear is sustainable, what gear, and where and when. So that's what, but we would have to do that. There's no doubt about it, and I'm not for a second suggesting that a three-mile limit would solve all our problems. A three-mile limit in the absence of fisheries management would be a complete waste of our time.
So, for example, if you're an established creel fisherman, you may have 650 creels, and you think, oh, three-mile limit, great, I'll increase to 1,000. So how are you proposing that there would be perhaps limits to the number of creels?
This would have to be based on the geographic area's carrying capacity. Now, this has been done. So in the Lion Bay project in the south of England, Plymouth University has established what is the carrying capacity of the various ecosystems. And that specifies the exact amount of creels that you can deploy in any given area, and then who gets to deploy them is based on historic entitlement and track record, or whether or not there's over or under capacity. I mean, we really have to manage the ecosystem at that resolution if we're going to implement ecosystems management. So you could have a national cap on the amount of creels. I mean, at the moment, and I think it's really worth emphasising here, because this is one of the issues that's led us to where we are today. At the moment, we have no effort controls or catch limits in our inshore fisheries. And that means you can have as many trawlers as you like trawling in the same place over and over again. There's no limit to the amount of trawling or creeling that you can have in any given place. And there's no limit to the amount of shellfish those trawlers or creelers can extract from a place. It's complete madness in the 21st century to have such an absence of management of our fisheries. So, yes, we would have to have effort limits and catch limits, for sure.
Thank you. And if I may, just very quickly, one final question. Clearly, because you're a creel fisherman, we've been focusing on that. But I'm interested to hear about what discussions you've had, what perhaps agreements you've had with other types of fishers about the three-mile limit.
I think you're going to find that anybody who is looking to be displaced by a three-mile limit is not going to be very much in favour of it, not at least until we can tell them how we can facilitate a just transition. Again, the Scottish Government has committed to this ecosystems-based approach, so I think it's up to the Scottish Government to tell us how they're going to achieve an ecosystems-based approach and good environmental status and do it in a just manner. From my point of view, I think we could subsidise the decommissioning of the smallest trawl boats, because those are the ones who are going to be impacted the most, and that we should help facilitate these guys wherever they want to come into the creel sector, which would be under capacity in the event of extensive spatial management. That would be my personal suggestion, but really I think it's up to the government to tell us how they're going to achieve good environmental status and how they're going to achieve a good an ecosystems-based approach, and then figure out how they're going to do it in a just manner. I don't think that's my responsibility.
Thank you.
Thank you. Jim Fairley.
Just following on from Jenny's question there, is it gear that is your biggest issue? The type of gear that is used in these inshore fisheries? Because you don't specifically mention gear in your petition. So is it gear that's the issue?
Gear and the management of that gear. And I think those two things cannot be separated. Because you can have sustainable trawling, don't get me wrong, but you just can't have very much of it. And you can have nowhere near as much of it as you could have sustainable creeling. And you can have unsustainable creeling. So I think that we have to recognise it's not just the gear, it's a combination of the gear and the management of that gear. And at the moment, we have no inshore fisheries management plans in Scotland. We have none. It's a free-for-all for all intents and purposes. There are no effort controls and no catch limits. There are no inshore-based fisheries management plans. If we had those, we might not need a three-mile limit. But if we had those and we tried to achieve good environmental status, we would have to introduce spatial management, there's, you know, the two things cannot be separated. You can't achieve good environmental status without reducing the impacts of demersal gear. The Scottish Government has recognised that the impacts of demersal gear on the ecosystem are the single biggest factor stopping us achieving good environmental status. So you can't achieve good environmental status without looking at the gear and the management of the gear.
Okay, thank you. I'm very mindful of Jenny's point that there's other people that are in the same waters at the moment, and there's going to have to be some balance there. Thank you, Convener.
Harry-Ann Burgess.
Which question are we on?
You had a supplementary on question 8.
Question 8, okay. Thanks. So I wonder if you could talk about, so you've started to talk about all the different components that would need to be in the mix. So it's not just the 3-mile limit, there's other elements that need to be there. And I wondered if you could talk about other ideas for minimising gear conflict, which could perhaps work alongside a 3-mile limit or alongside the spatial management measures. So you mentioned the inner sound pilot and territorial rights and that kind of thing. If you could just expand on that.
It really comes down to fisheries management plans. And so a fisheries management, a fit-for-purpose fisheries management plan that applied the ecosystems approach and that sought to achieve good environmental status, because those are the foundational principles that we should be working towards, it would dictate who could fish where and what gear they could use. And so one of the interesting things is as you transition towards more selective gear and gear with a reduced impact on the environment, often you actually end up with a higher employment ratio because these gears attract this premium. So I think in order to reduce the detrimental impacts of extensive spatial management, you would want to facilitate a transition as much as possible from people from higher impact gears towards lower impact gears. That way you can actually generate more employment without taking any more resource out of the system. I mean, there's a whole array of things that we can do to make this work better and to mitigate the negative consequences. But I think we've always got to remember that if we want to achieve good environmental status, we can't do it without reducing seabed disturbance. If we want to reduce seabed disturbance, we can't do it without reducing the amount of trawling and dredging. If we want to reduce the amount of trawling and dredging, then we either have to transition these guys to lower impact fishing, or we have to decommission those elements of the fishing industry. And some may argue that that's not just, but that all leads back to the commitment to achieve good environmental status in the first place. So I really think, to some degree, the Scottish Government's got to demonstrate how it's going to achieve good environmental status. And our petition says that they can't do it without extensive spatial management, and a variation of a 3-mile limit would be a really good place to start.
Just to follow up on that, Convener, thank you. So obviously in the Bute House Agreement, there's the highly protected marine areas, and you have been talking about the 58% of highly damaged seabed, and that, the intention with that is a land-lash bay approach of a no-take zone. And I'd be interested to hear how, I think one of the things that's come out today is that it's not a blanket 3-mile limit and that there's a more nuanced approach. And it seems to me that we would need some places around the coastline where there's really no-take zones. I'd be interested to hear your reflections and thoughts of how we could fit that into the spatial management mix.
Again, I think it's context. Everything is context here. So highly protected marine areas in a context of a fishing industry that's over capacity, where there's spatial squeeze, there's no fisheries management plans, are potentially just compounding the problem. If we believe the Scottish Government's report that 50% of our fishing effort is already above maximum sustainable yield, so therefore by definition unsustainable, I think you have to excuse me. Sorry. I think the introduction of highly protected marine areas in that context has got a potentially detrimental effect. And by that, I mean, if we're already at overcapacity and we remove 10% of the opportunity from the fishing industry, but not 10% of the fishing industry, then we just compound the extent to which everything else is overcapacity, or we make the viability of the existing fishing businesses marginal or more marginal. That doesn't mean to say we shouldn't have highly protected marine areas. It means to say if we want highly protected marine areas to work and to be beneficial, it has to be part of a comprehensive fisheries management plan. Hypothetically, if your fishing industry was under capacity, it really would not be harmful to create no-take zones or highly protected marine areas. But if your fishing industry is over capacity, which by the Scottish Government's own study says that it is, then introducing highly protected marine areas is only going to make things worse. So I don't think the argument is for or against highly protected marine areas. I think the argument has to be if you want to introduce highly protected marine areas, it should be part of a comprehensive fisheries management plan, and we should look at mitigating the negative consequences of doing that.
Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Just very, very quick response. Do you think HPMAs could be sited on wind farm, offshore wind farm, where fishing opportunities are severely restricted anyway, so it wouldn't add then to this, as much to the spatial squeeze or additional fishing pressures?
It's not simple, because there are consequences for these wind farms, and there's already a big study going into the impacts of electromagnetic interference on the migration of shellfish, and until we can see the results of that, I couldn't give you an informed answer, because if it turns out that these cables are interfering substantially with the movements of shellfish, then they obviously wouldn't achieve what was meant to be achieved by highly protected marine areas. But it would be nice to see some of the areas that are already close to fishing because of military sites or other designations being included in these highly protected marine areas. Otherwise, we're losing not 10% of our inshore area, we're losing 10% of our fishing grounds.
Okay, thank you. Rachel Hamilton.
Okay, so first of all, I just want to, you know, when you get back to us, to the committee, on the 58% figure that you used, is that, could you clarify whether that's areas where trawling happens or the assessed areas, please? You don't need to answer now, but just to add to that. I also want to ask you a little bit about the backing that you've got of your petition. It says that it's you on behalf of the SCFF. Do all your members support your petition?
Yes. So, but I should clarify here that Scottish Creel Fishermen's Federation represent creelers and divers, but we only represent about 200 of Scotland's almost 2,000. So we only represent about 10% of Scotland's creel fishers. So it would be wrong to give you the impression that all of Scotland's creel fishers support this measure. And to be honest with you, I think the support for it or not for it is neither here nor there. I think what's important is that can we meet our international legal obligations without it?
Of those 200, are they active fisher people? Okay. How is your organisation funded?
A mixture of members' fees, which actually we've not levied in this last year, because we have a nice grant from the Esme Fairbairn Foundation, which is paying me a part-time wage. I'm actually a full-time fisherman, and I represent and advocate for the interests of creel fishermen on a part-time basis, and that position has been funded by the Esme Fairbairn Foundation.
Okay. I'm interested as well, going back to some of the points that you make about the socio-economic benefit that the intention of the petition could have. Would the price of nephrops increase, do you believe, and pricing us out of the domestic market, and then foreign imports would be replacing that domestic market?
Yeah, so it's very complex. I mean, I can only rely on the work of the New Economics Foundation and Professor Alan Radford, who's an economics professor who was commissioned by Marine Scotland to produce the original three-mile limit assessing the options for change report, but they concluded that the economics would be, you know, credible in that we would not saturate the market and that we would not overinflate the price of prawns such that it would negate the jobs. So I can only rely on these guys. I'm not an economist. I believe there was maybe a third piece of work which I haven't mentioned, which was carried out by Seafood Scotland, that said that we could increase the amount of live nephrops going to the market by 10%. Not 10% of the existing, 10% more of Scotland's nephrops could go to the live market without creating negative economic repercussions.
And I just wondered if what you would say to the Scottish Fishermen's Federation, who argue that the three-mile limit is a protectionist approach that benefits only one type of fishing?
I think it's half right and half wrong. So the protectionist approach, arguably yes, and I don't think that's necessarily a bad thing. We're talking about protecting the ecosystem. We're talking about protecting our legal obligations to achieve good environmental status. Whether or not it would benefit only one type of fishing, I would disagree. I think that's wrong, because we're talking about being able to net and handline and creel, and then within creeling, we've got there's lots of types of fishing within creeling. There's wrasse, there's whelk, there's crab, several types of crab, there's lobster, and there's nephrops. And in the future, if we can develop a higher abundance of demersal finfish in the inshore, we can actually use variations on creeling, trap-type fishing to catch fish. So I think the argument that it would only benefit one type of fishing is wrong. It would benefit a huge range of fisheries that have historically been marginalised by creating a big free-for-all within the inshore.
I expect to have to produce, I would say, a financial impact assessment, whether it's negative or positive, alongside your petition?
I think it's incumbent upon the Scottish Government to produce a social economic impact assessment on whatever mechanism they propose to achieve good environmental status. And at the moment, our petition is that the Scottish Government aren't proposing anything which could possibly achieve good environmental status. But I think it would be incumbent upon the Scottish Government to show how they would do that.
Thanks, Convener.
Hey, Karen Adam.
Thank you, Convener. This would have an impact on mobile gear fishers, and I'm just wondering how you propose to mitigate or compensate them for that.
So personally, I can think of lots of mechanisms whereby we can mitigate and to some degree compensate. So mitigate, I would suggest that the increased capacity for more keel boats in the inshore would create an opportunity for some people to transition, so that would be a mitigation to some extent. For those who either didn't want to or were unable to transition, I think we would have to look at some sort of compensation. Traditionally, in the fishing industry, we use mechanisms like decommissioning. We speculated in our 2017 proposal at the Scottish Inshore Fisheries Conference, where we suggested the three-mile limit in the first instance, that you could start with a base figure of about £100,000, which would reflect the value of an under 10-metre trawler and would be at least the minimum that you would have to contribute towards facilitating these guys to maybe go out and buy a creel boat. Now, that produced a range of outcomes depending on how many boats would be requesting this type of compensation, and the figures were between £10 and £15 million. And I think we should contextualise that the Scottish Government have committed £14 million recently to incentivise new entrants into the fishing industry. And it's not working very well, because nobody wants to go into a fishing industry that's unsustainable and in decline. If we want to bring new entrants to the fishing industry, that £14 million would have been far better spent creating opportunity within the inshore.
That's good. If I could just come back in there. And obviously, I mean, we're talking in an economic sense here, and we're talking about compensatory in a fiscal way. But there's also a lot of history, culture, heritage that comes along with that. And, you know, even talking about the, I suppose, the attachment that people have to that life and possibly family history as well. From that side of things, what sort of compensatory or mitigations could be in place for these people?
And I think the question has to be, you know, we're starting with the wrong question. The question is, how do we achieve good environmental status? That is our legal obligation. How do we, under the Sustainable Development Goals, UN Sustainable Development Goals, which we're signed up to, we have to fish within maximum sustainable yield. How do we achieve that? And under those same goal, United Nations Sustainable Development Goals 14B, we have to incentivise small-scale and artisanal fisheries. We have to show how we're going to do that. If we show how we're going to achieve good environmental status, incentivise low-impact fishing, and fish within sustainable limits, and also take an ecosystems approach. These are all commitments that we already have. We have to demonstrate how we're going to achieve that. In fact, it's incumbent upon the Scottish Government to demonstrate how they're going to achieve that. Then at that point, we can look at comprehensive inshore fisheries management plans, and maybe we can identify who the beneficiaries and the victims are going to be, and we can start discussing compensation. But I think if you're going to discuss compensation at this stage, you've put the cart before the horse, because at the moment we don't know who we would be compensating. We don't even have fisheries management plans that tell us where we're over capacity and where we're under capacity. So we really have to start by developing comprehensive inshore fisheries management plans that would allow us to deal with spatial squeeze, achieving good environmental status, and so on and so forth.
Supplement from Rachel Hamilton.
I want to take you back to the closure of the Clyde Cod Box. Members of the party in government right now called for fishermen to be compensated after the new measures were introduced to protect the cod stocks in the Firth of Clyde. You talked about decommissioning, and you talked about a just transition. Would you support compensation for individuals that have been displaced? Thank you.
Just for the record, I think it might be helpful. Colleagues probably know this, but I think it would be helpful to understand what we're talking about in terms of numbers. I understand it's like around 2,100 registered fishing vessels, but how does that break down into creelers, you know, approximately? I know that there's 21 pelagic boats, but what's the mix with the other?
Numbers in front of me, but I think just to give us an idea for context. First of all, without fisheries management plan, I know I keep saying this, but without fisheries management plans, it's really hard to identify where we have over and under capacity, and then in turn, who would be displaced, how many would be displaced, and so on and so forth. However, I think it's reasonable to suggest that if a three-mile limit and an extensive inshore spatial management were created tomorrow, the smallest trawlers would suffer the worst. And for context, there's 85 under 10-metre trawlers on the whole west coast of Scotland. On the mainland of Scotland. I think there's only 35 on the west coast mainland. There's 85 under 10-metre trawlers in Scotland. And these guys would arguably be substantially detrimentally affected by an inshore limit. After that, we've got to say, well, how would the 10 to 12-metre sector be impacted? And then how would the 12 to 14-metre sector? And again, without comprehensive inshore fisheries management plans, we have no clue. And you know, one of the reasons we find ourselves in this situation, one of the reasons we're petitioning for this limit, is because in the absence of comprehensive inshore area-based or ecosystems-based fisheries management plans, we're kind of acting blind here and we're clunky. I mean, the Scottish Government have complained that this is a blanket approach, but a blanket approach is allowing trawling and dredging inshore in an area where we've committed to achieving good environmental status.
Thank you. Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Convener. You've touched on some of this already, but I just wondered what the implications are for Marine Scotland and others in terms of enforcing the kind of solution that you would like to see.
I think it would be complicated, and that's one of the reasons why we've not done it. But on paper, we're committed to doing it. So, again, if we want to take an ecosystem-based approach and achieve good environmental status, we have to develop comprehensive fisheries management plans. That means there's going to be lots of complicated and nuanced fisheries regulations that are going to be right down to the local scale. And I think, to some degree, that's going to involve a degree of co-management. I think Marine Scotland are going to have to let go of the reins to some degree and allow communities to develop fisheries management plans in line with scientific advice and facilitated by both scientists and Marine Scotland staff. But I think it would be very hard for Marine Scotland to micromanage fishing at the scale that is actually required to achieve good environmental status, and that's one of the reasons why Marine Scotland hasn't embraced this idea before now. But it's not impossible. Plenty of places do it, and with modern technology, the Scottish Government is committed to implementing comprehensive vessel tracking by the end of this parliamentary term, and that would facilitate to a huge extent the kind of management that would be required to achieve good environmental status.
Thank you.
Mercedes Villalba.
Thank you. So, Bally, as you'll know, the Bute House Agreement of November 2021 committed the Scottish Government to introducing highly protected marine areas and to capping fishing activity in inshore waters. The consultation on the highly protected marine areas was only launched in December and it's currently underway, and the consultation on a cap on fishing activity hasn't yet begun, as far as I'm aware. So to what extent would these proposals address the concerns raised in your petition? And based on the current pace of work by the Scottish Government on these commitments, do you see any dangers if this committee were to close your petition today prior to any progress on the commitments from the government actually being delivered?
So, yeah, there's a couple of different things in there. So the highly protected marine areas will contribute to some degree towards achieving good environmental status. Now, highly disturbed areas are what we need to have less of in order to achieve good environmental status. And you would have to put the whole 10% that we've committed to as highly protected marine areas on highly disturbed areas in order for it to contribute just 10% to those highly disturbed areas, and we're needing 30 to 40%. So they will contribute to some extent, but they will certainly not solve the problem. And I think in absence of other measures, capping the inshore fleet at its present unsustainable levels will not contribute meaningfully at all. As a mechanism from where we can reduce effort, yes, that sets us up to be able to start working towards achieving good environmental status. But if you cap inshore effort at current unsustainable levels and then remove 10% of the fishing opportunity without removing 10% of the fishing fleet, it could actually make things worse.
And in terms of the second part of the question, of if the committee was to close the petition, do you see any dangers in that?
Well, I think historical precedent shows that Marine Scotland previously had commitments in 2010 to achieve good environmental status, and by 2020 it looked like we had categorically failed on almost every single metric. I think we fail 11 of the 14 metrics by which we measure good environmental status. So, and I don't think there's been a root and branch review of what happened, what went wrong, what failures led us to not achieving good environmental status within the time that we had committed to doing it. And I don't believe that any mechanism has been introduced to make sure that we're not going to just repeat that failure. So my concern would be that regardless of all the government's fancy words about what they intend to do, that history has proven that they've not done it in the past, and I can see no reason to believe why they would be doing it in the next 10 years.
Thanks.
Thank you. I don't believe we have any further questions, so can I thank you most sincerely for your evidence you've given us today. It's been very thorough and under heavy questioning, so I'm sure the committee will all join me in thanking you for that. We'll now take a brief suspension to allow the witness to leave and a comfort break. Thank you. Okay. We now return to option agenda item one, and we've got to look at, in terms of our next step, what decisions we're going to take on whether to close or continue the petition. In my view, and I think everybody's view, spatial management of the marine environment is incredibly important, and we've heard lots of evidence this morning. The Scottish Government has recently begun its review of the National Marine Plan, and the Cabinet Secretary did write to us in October explaining that the review would establish, and I quote, a clear policy framework that reflects our new shared priorities and commitment that considers potential co-dependencies, synergies and trade-offs between interests. In my view, I think that commitment from the government would allow us to close the petition, but for us as a committee to pay regard to what we've heard in the petition today in our future work programme. Any comments? Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. I think that's a good approach. I would just raise one concern that I think we should get clarity, because I did hear Bally, when we raised them, I think you asked him about the marine plan. I think he said that the existing marine plan didn't really deal with fisheries, so I would want to get assurances that absolutely fisheries is in that plan, and that's what, for the future plan, that the government is including fisheries in the mix there.
Okay, thank you.
I think Rachel was first. But
oh, Rachel Hamilton.
Yeah, I think the petitioner gave, compelling evidence and answered our questions very, very well. But the scope of the petition for me is requires a kind of a multi-approach strategy. And I think that the government needs to ensure that they are working on the issues that the petitioner raised, where there is a glaring deficit of, meeting targets. For example, he said, without a comprehensive inshore management plan, we are blind. But he also mentioned that the government should be responsible for ensuring that we're looking at the financial impact of the suggestion of the petition. So therefore, I think there is a lot more work that the government can do, and I would recommend that the petition at this point is closed.
Okay. Mercedes Villalba.
Thanks, Convener. So I think we should keep the petition open. It's not clear to me what the Scottish Government's position is, as it's still consulting on these issues. And as the petitioner pointed out, we have had very strong commitments in the past which haven't materialised into action. So I think it would be premature to close this petition until we have a clear position from the government and an outcome on those consultations.
Okay. Any other views? Jim Fairley.
Yeah, no, I would agree with your position that we close the petition at this stage. The evidence that Bally gave was absolutely tremendous, very detailed, but we're only hearing from that particular petitioner. And I think there will be other people within the fishing community who will also want to give as much evidence as has been given on that. So as the government is doing its reviews, I think we need to be mindful of that, and therefore I'd close the petition just now and take it in the broader picture that we're going to be looking at later in this term.
Thank you, Jim. Alistair Allen.
Yeah, likewise, I think the issues today and the petition were given a good hearing, and we can maybe give a more comprehensive one to the wider issues in our later work as a committee. So that would make the case, I think, for closing it for the moment.
Karen Arum.
Yeah, likewise, I'm inclined to agree with closing the petition, but I felt that the evidence we heard today was great. We had a good in-depth question and session. I wouldn't like to see that go to waste. I think there's still a lot of work ongoing at the moment, and until a lot of that work settles and we can get some proposed outcomes from that although we do close, I propose to close the petition, that we do keep in mind the session from today and add that to any business in the future.
Okay. Any other views? Jenny Minto.
Thank you, Convener. I agree with what Karen Adam has just said. I think we got very thorough evidence today, and we need to take strong account of that. I think it's important, though, that we hear from other other groups of fishermen on this subject and would agree with taking it forward and making this an important part of any scrutiny we further do on fishing issues around Scotland.
Thank you. So I think the majority of the opinion is we close the petition and incorporate consideration of spatial management of inshore fisheries in our future consideration of the National Marine Plan. And if that National Marine Plan does come to us as the lead committee, I can assure the petitioner that we will engage extensively with all stakeholders and, of course, engage with the petitioner and the SCFF when that opportunity arises.
Are we going to take a vote on that?
We can, but I think the majority, from what I hear, is in favour of closing the petition. I don't think we need to take a vote.
As long as it's noted that I wanted to keep it open.
Yeah, your views are on record.
Thank you.
Thank you. So the members in agreement that we close the petition. Thank you. That is agreed. We will now move into private session.